Space for many people has and continues to represent the future. It's where people are going. It's the place we haven't been yet. I've been fascinated by space ever since I can remember. I was a little kid growing up in New York City in the 50s. My dad used to take me to the planetarium. There was something about seeing all those planets and stars and meteors and comets. They just somehow excited me. And that was just before what we look at as the birth of the space age. There was the Disney television program. You know, they had Frontierland and Fantasyland, and they also had Tomorrowland, which was all about space. So whenever they had a space program, I would always watch it with great interest.
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
When we actually landed on the moon for the first time, I was with a bunch of my friends. It was the summer, and, you know, it was an interesting feeling because I realized the way my friends were talking that this was something unanticipated, unheard of, something that was so incredible. And, I mean, I was excited and overwhelmed at the same time, but it was not incredible. To me, I had always expected that we were going to the moon. But then along came the space shuttle. I was at that point working at the Center for Space Research at MIT. Before it was launched, they realized they were going to need new astronauts, and the shuttle had a crew of seven, only needed two pilots, so they specifically put out calls for scientists, engineers, medical doctors, and when I heard that, hey, this is my chance. So I mentioned to my father that, you know, Dad, I've decided to apply to be an astronaut. And he thought about it for a minute and he said, yeah, that makes sense. We were riding out to the launch pad and, you know, as you get close and you look up and there's the shuttle sitting there. And I remember thinking to myself, well, yeah, this is not the time to be thinking, do I really want to do this or not? That was a decision I made back when I was 6 years old.
Charlie just crawled in. He's the last one but me.
Houston Discovery, how do you read?
The next thing we heard was, can we do a manual reset at T-minus 9? We're go, and clock is starting. You know, I'm not even strapped in my seat. My colleague was not strapped in his seat. You know, what the? And so quickly, you know, we strapped in, and it was probably T-minus 5 minutes before it really sunk into me. We're going.
3, 2, 1.
All of a sudden, everything starts shaking.
There's a fire burning in the hydrogen burn-off tank. This is phenomenal.
And the ground just falls straight down, and you're going straight up. You break the sound barrier in about 45, 50 seconds going straight up. People had told me there was gonna be a lot of vibration, but still, when we went supersonic, the vibration got even stronger. And I was thinking, this can't be normal, you know, the wings are gonna fall off or something.
What a ride, all right.
But then it gets very quiet, and I sort of floated out of my seat and over the window and looked out, and there was the coast of Africa coming over the horizon. And that's when it hit me, you know, you're in space. We're really in orbit.
Nice to be in orbit.
And I remember looking in the mirror, and I had this grin from one ear to the other, and I couldn't stop smiling. I was just so excited. There was never a single morning that I would wake up and I wasn't happy to be in space. And there is something very, very powerful about looking at the Earth from the outside. It's a different place than when you're actually standing on it. Not only do you have the stars above, but you have all of the lights of human civilization down below. Now you can see that from an airplane at night, but the scale is so different. From an airplane, you look out and you can maybe see a whole city stretched out below you, whereas from a spacecraft in orbit, you can see an entire country or continent. The people who would develop, we used film in those days, and they would develop and look at the initial film. And after, I think, two or three of my flights, it became standard. This must have been one of Hoffman's flights, because half the pictures are of sunrises and sunsets. The other thing that you see, which I really hadn't heard that much about, when you look at the Earth at night, there's a bright line, that's above the horizon. That's a layer in our atmosphere. It's about 60 miles above the ground, and oxygen and nitrogen atoms get excited during the day by the sun's radiation. And then at night, they re-emit that, and it's this ethereal, it's like a halo, you know, pictures of halos around angels' heads. That's sort of what it looks like around the Earth. Astronauts talk a lot about the experience of weightlessness because it's certainly the most unique aspect of spaceflight from a personal point of view. The feeling of weightlessness, it's that feeling of freedom, being able to push off a wall with your little finger and just float across the cabin like Superman. Both the feeling of your own body and the things that you can do. You know, you blow a little water drop just to see a globule of water floating there, and you can sort of poke it, and it's truly a new world. It's like mountain climbing in a sense. You can't stay on the summit forever. You know, space is higher than the highest mountaintop, so that sense of being removed from normal life on the Earth and the incredible experiences that we're having up there are that much stronger. But yeah, you do have to come down. It takes a while to get used to being back, but all those sensations, they fade away pretty quickly.
We are now going to make a video of Orin the Lego Master.
There's no question, space flight, it's a peak experience. And what do you do after a peak experience? After the Hubble mission, for instance, walked into the house, my wife points at the washing machine. All right, Mr. Hubble repairman, you were up there fixing the Hubble Space Telescope. Well, while you were gone, the washing machine broke, so fix that. What else do you do after having done something so incredible? I mean, just sit around regretting for the rest of my life that it's over and I can't do it anymore? When I first decided that I wasn't going to fly again, that's when I started to dream a lot about space. Obviously, I loved it so much that subconsciously I was feeling this separation, and I would even have dreams about space cowboy sort of dreams. You know, they're coming back, Jeff, we need you, now come back and fly. I don't have those dreams anymore, although I'd still do it in an instant if somebody came and asked me. When I still go out from time to time just to look at the space station when it's going to fly right overhead. But sometimes a little bit later in the evening, it will rise in the west, but then it enters the Earth's shadow. And if you watch it very closely, for the last 2 or 3 seconds before it disappears, instead of being the bright white, it turns red. And that brings me back to what it was like looking at the sunsets, because the sun sets very quickly. But for a few seconds, the whole spacecraft turns red, and then it's gone.